Here are 5 interesting things you may not have known about Call of Duty Zombies. First up, we have Element 115. It's what powers almost everything in the zombie storyline. From the pack-a-punch, to several unique weapons, to even the zombies themselves. But did you know that Element 115 could actually be biomatter? So for those of you who don't know, biomatter is matter of biological origin. So these will include things like the wood used in fireplaces, or the straw used in baskets or a straw hat. Basically, it's going to be any plant or animal material. And there's plenty of evidence in zombies to indicate that 115 is biomatter made from Apothicon blood. Now, we know from several radios in Origins that 115 has the ability to open up dimensional portals and to sort the space-time continuum. Maxis states that things like the mystery box are able to give our characters weapons from different eras because of 115's disruptive abilities. But what's more interesting is that Apothicons themselves seem to be able to do this. We see in the Intro to Revelations, for example, that Apothicons are opening up dimensional portals, using this method to infect different timelines with 115. Weapons like the Apothicon Servant, for example, which is just basically one of these monsters in your palm, also seem to create this kind of effect, sucking in zombies through what looks like a black hole. And Gersh devices, literally the black hole bombs of the series, are implied through a radio intact or tone to function using the negative space found in Apothicon blood. So there seems to be a link between 115 and the DNA of Apothicons in the way that they both can alter time and space around them. If we also look at the way that 115 affects those exposed to it, we start to see another link between 115 and Apothicon blood. Zombies, for example, display murderous aggression and overt hostility from the moment they're created. They can also survive wounds that would normally be fatal, and they come back stronger and more powerful after they've been reanimated by 115. In Tagertone, Yina tells Gersh that after being exposed to Apothicon blood, space monkeys, like zombies, become more robust, surviving near-death experiences. But like zombies, they also show a dramatic increase in violence. Yina even relates that Apothicon blood reacts negatively to the poking and prodding of the Ascension group, telling Gersh that the blood seems to get angrier the more it is experimented with. Now, if we think all the way back to the radios in Darius and the first zombie experiments, Dr. Maxis records that the infected also react in this manner when tested on extensively. He even has to kill the first few batches of zombies because they're way too dangerous to be around. Therefore, there seems to be another link between 115 and Apothicon blood in that they both cause similar symptoms of violence in whatever they infect. And finally, we have what looks like 115 coming from the Apothicons themselves. Again, in the Intro to Revelations, Apothicons seem to be siphoning energy from a blue sun and then transforming it into 115, possibly by mixing this energy with their blood and then turning it into a solid. Now, if this sounds somewhat crazy to you, like almost impossible, something like this actually happens in real life. Let's take a look at the way that oysters create pearls. Pearls are made from something called calcium carbonate, a chemical that makes up the shell of a mollusk, and forms when an irritant, like a parasite, gets into the shell of an oyster and then triggers the oyster to begin coating the irritant in the carbonate. But what's even crazier is that, according to a research paper from 2013, pearls actually contain DNA of the mollusk that made them. And this seems to be what Apothicons do with the energy from this blue sun, turning the 115 into something physically tangible, using their own genetic material, just like an oyster. So, has 115 really been biomatter from a living thing this entire time? It looks like there's plenty of evidence to think about 115 in this way. Number 2. Way back in the early days of the zombie storyline, it was made pretty clear to us that the Nazis had an enormous investment in resurrecting the dead and then weaponizing them against Allied forces. In fact, one of the only reasons that zombies were able to grow to such large numbers in the original timeline was because Germany gave Group 935 the necessary funding to keep churning them out, eventually leading to the outbreaks that we see at Verrückt, Shinonuma, and Darius. In the altered timeline of BO3, we also see that Germany was interested in the resurrection of ancient dragons, using them to break the stalemate between the Germans and Russians in the Battle of Stalingrad. Now, while all this seems pretty cool, and Nazi zombies have been the subject of countless books, movies, video games, and etc., the real Nazi Germany was actually more interested in resurrecting ancient cows than zombies or dragons. In the 1920s, a German zoologist named Lutz Heck sought to recreate the extinct ancestor of the cow, the Auroch, by backbreeding it through specific species of domestic cattle, for example, by mixing Spanish fighting bulls with Swiss cows. The result was a new breed of animal called Heck cattle, and many of them were shipped to the private hunting grounds of Hermann Göring, Hitler's second-in-command, where he could reenact scenes from ancient German poems. Heck cattle are still alive today, and they can be found all over Central and Western Europe in both zoos and agricultural pastures. Now, what's interesting is that Lutz wanted to resurrect animals from a period in German history that was supposedly free of racial impurities, aka medieval Germany. And it just so happened that the Nazis were also extremely interested in recapturing and reliving this portion of Germany's past. But what's even more intriguing about this obsession with the mythical antiquity is that we can actually make a small connection here with the dragons in Gorod Krovi. Germany may have chosen to resurrect them specifically because of their cultural significance to medieval times and Germanic lore. This may also be the reason why we see so many references to German mythology in Gorod Krovi, a Russian map. For example, the dragon shield is named after Fafnir, the son of a Norse king turned into a dragon, while the special weapon of the map is named after Siegfried, the hero who killed Fafnir. Well, speculation aside, resurrecting zombies and dragons are cool and all, but the Nazis were a bit more interested in creating the next super cow than reviving monsters. Number 3. What's up with all the ghost birds and the Blood of the Dead Easter egg? From getting back the Cranorium, to some of the most questionable puzzle solving in the history of this mode, to escaping the rock itself, birds are involved in nearly every step of Blood's Easter egg. Fun fact, ghost birds can appear more than 40 times during the main quest. There are 38 possible spawn locations for the Cranorium bird. 3 will appear during the powerhouse step, watching you as you shield blast the panels, and one more arrives to free Primus from their cells near the end of the Easter egg. The name Alcatraz is even taken from the Spanish Alcatraces, which means Island of the Pelicans, and it was named as such because of the huge population of birds the first Europeans on the island encountered in 1769. So clearly, these birds are important to the world building in the game. Why are they referenced so much? Before it came into possession of the US in 1848, and long before it was ever a prison, Alcatraz was actually used by the Ohlone tribe of the San Francisco Bay Area, mainly as a place of exile or banishment for members who violated tribal laws. Now, a lot of animals are featured in the mythology of this tribe, but two species in particular are repeatedly mentioned, canines and birds. According to tribal legends, the coyote and the eagle were responsible for creating our world after the old one was destroyed by a flood. The eagle saves the coyote from drowning by carrying him away from the waters, and after the world dries out, the coyote is put in charge of repopulating the earth, therefore making the coyote humanity's father, and the bird humanity's protector. Evidently, birds and canines are of extreme importance to the Ohlone tribe, but again, what does this have to do with the birds on Alcatraz? Well, I believe the ghost birds are a reference to the birds in Ohlone mythology because of two things. One, we actually see what looks like a Native American headdress with a coyote on it on a coin in the brew machine. And yeah, I do believe it's a coyote and not a wolf, because A, coyotes don't have round ears, they have pointed ones, like the animal you're seeing here. And B, coyotes have pointier noses, just like the one on the brew coin. And secondly, we know Treyarch likes to incorporate little tidbits of history of locations into their maps. For example, the Blundergat in Mob and Blood resembles Civil War-era weaponry, like the Blunderbuss and Gatling Gun. A nice attention to detail, given that Alcatraz was actually turned into a fort during the Civil War. Additionally, we have the Tomahawk, a weapon that was used by most North American Indians, including the Ohlone, and even the afterlife symbol resembles the Eye of the Medicine Man, a sigil found in many Native American cultures. To me, the ghost birds in the Blood of the Dead Easter egg act a lot like the birds in Ohlone mythology. They're benevolent, and they lead the way out of the darkness in the island towards a better future. Number 4. What was the true purpose of Transit and Die Rise? Now, I don't know about you, but looking back at Black Ops 2 Zombies as a whole, I always feel the least attachment and curiosity for Transit and Die Rise because, apart from a few radios here and there, there really didn't seem to be much of a story behind them at the time. Transit was just a bunch of seemingly random locations all connected by a bus, so it was more like a small town than anything, while Die Rise... Well, actually, I think Die Rise is the most self-explanatory map of the two. A couple of crumbling Chinese towers during the end of the world alongside an awesome skybox. Cool! Well, one of the things Black Ops 4 did was to actually expand the story of these two facilities. If we look at the world map in Alpha Omega, right by where Rushmore is, we see that Transit, or the Hanford campus, was a site where applications testing was done, while Die Rise was where weapons and bios were experimented with. So let's start with Transit. In real life, the Hanford site was a nuclear production complex in Washington that was also home to the first full-scale plutonium production reactor. The plutonium manufactured here was actually used in the first nuclear bomb ever detonated, the Gadget device at the Trinity site in New Mexico, as well as the Fat Man bomb, which ignited over the city of Nagasaki in 1945. Now, what's interesting is that there seems to be a slight reference to the plutonium produced at Hanford in Transit. The Pack-a-Punch camo looks very similar to plutonium itself, a silvery gray color with streaks of olive and yellow, exactly the color plutonium turns into when exposed to the air for extended periods of time. Additionally, the Hanford site was producing so much plutonium during the 1960s that the facility needed enormous amounts of power just to keep functioning. Now, if you think about the power station in Transit, there's a huge structure in the center of the reactor that first houses the Avogadro, itself a being of seemingly infinite energy that was created by the elemental shard, which also produces unlimited power. What I think was going on in the power station, and this has never been officially confirmed by Treyarch, but it's a nice little headcanon for me, is that the facility needed more energy in the 1960s to keep experimenting with plutonium and 115, that they actually sent the Department of Defense to fetch the elemental shard from Nuketown, since the US government learned of its infinite potential from experiments Cornelius Purnell was making in 1964 from Peter McCain. This way, the facility could keep making plutonium and 115 with one stroke, but when the facility shut down in the late 1960s, the shard was kept in the possession of the US government until the 1980s, when it was transferred to the Province 22 facility, or Die Rise, for experimentation with animals. Then, in 2025, Primus teleported the Avogadro to Transit in the same structure that contained the elemental shard, where we first encountered the creature in 2035 with Victus. But what's up with Transit being called the Applications Testing Site, you may be wondering? Well, Applications Testing is another name for software testing, where you find the functionality, usability, and consistency of an entire software program. And what do we see in Transit that seems pre-programmed, provides a quick way to get from one place to another, and yells slurs and allegations at you? The bus driver. The entire facility of Transit may have been a giant testing site for the bus driver, as we can see in blueprints from Classified that engineers want to work on making the driver more friendly and approachable, as its appearance and behavior unnerves the employees at Hanford. It may be that the bus driver was planned to be mass-produced for various Broken Arrow facilities, as the Classified blueprints also state that the bus itself comes from an unidentified Colorado facility. So why would Broken Arrow go through the trouble of getting parts for its experiments from different locations if it didn't plan on distributing it on a mass scale? We also hear the bus driver describe various locations that are certainly not in Transit, like Hawaii, the Grand Canyon, Yellowstone, and even Groom Lake, where the teleporter for the moon is located. This implies the bus driver was indeed going to be produced for different areas, and possibly even distributed for commercial use. So now let's quickly move on to Province 22 facility, Die Rise. Now, relations between the US and China from the end of World War II onwards have been, for the most part, kind of like a roller coaster. You get really thrilling highs, and then very scary lows. But beginning in 1972, the two countries tried to normalize relations between them by having then US President Richard Nixon sign the Shanghai Communique, which would allow for China and the US to discuss matters of urgency and work towards finding solutions. This, I believe, sets the stage up for the creation of the Die Rise facility. We know from the world map in Alpha Omega that Direz was actually a Broken Arrow initiative, most likely created as a joint US-China establishment that would allow for the sharing of resources, like 115, to combat the Soviet Union, which was seen by both countries as a much greater threat at the height of the Cold War. So, the Direz facility began experimenting with the elemental shard alongside American and Chinese scientists with animals in the 1980s, and they in turn created the bios. Interestingly, we can see on several floors of the map a multitude of animal cages littered about, presumably where animals were held before they were experimented on with the shard. In the Call of Duty Zombie comics, we get our first look at the bios in issue number 2, and they are enormous, grotesque monsters that seem to have the upper hand against zombies, with one even managing to pin down the undead Richtofen for a short time. They shred zombies with ease, are immortal according to Russman, and they don't seem to be under the command of any kind of leader like other organisms infected with 115. This is significant because we know from Classified that Broken Arrow was created specifically to fight against Samantha, so these bios may have been the perfect weapon to go up against an army of the undead. Yet, it seems they could have been controlled by Broken Arrow under any means, and they ended up killing all of the organization's employees, save for Russman. Direz lay undisturbed until 2035, when Victus arrives at the facility to power the second polarization device for Maxis. And finally, number 5. Here's how to get a free max ammo on Zetsubou no Shima. So what you want to do is head over to the bunker area, then go towards where you find the artillery machine, then pull out your Skull of Nonsapwe, and mesmerize the wall to the right of the viable debris. And there you go. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.